poems. Some of them are from my book, Homecoming, which is out in the lobby and is for sale. The first one is written for Scott Kanitz and was told to me in a community that I know well this winter, something that happened this winter. It's "Call Me Ishmael." He could have said, "Call me Ishmael," but he said, "My name is Scott." He banged on the door of our friend's house in the middle of the night, in the midst of the storm, torrents of rain, wind at 25 knots. They heard his voice and opened their door to find the almost dead, almost drowned, should by rights be dead, should be drowned, Scott, barely alive, crawled off his beached boat, come through a storm fierce enough to make an ocean liner turn back. Awake over 36 hours, he used his skill to save his own life. Sailing through 40-foot seas, 60-mile-an-hour winds, riding up each wave, steering into each wave, knowing that hitting one sideways would be the last thing he'd ever do. Running bare poles before the wind, slowing the boat by using the brogue as a drag behind it, by making a break to slow the boat down, tying sails together, lashing the rope ends to the boat, and pitching the sails into the water behind. At last, when he could have died, he cried as he said this to me. He wanted to die, just wanted it over. He thought of jumping into the sea where he feared he'd end up. But he hung on, minute by minute, hour by hour, blown 200 miles off course. Electronics sizzled by lightning. Lost, lost, lost. Until he saw Hopetown's lighthouse. Somehow, he made it, pushed by the wind and the waves, over the reef and the rocks, onto the sandy shore, where he beached for good, where he could have kissed the land, before he came to a house and knocked on the door. This is a shanty town called The Mud. The flames were bad enough. The flames, the chaos, the noise, the fear, the running and grabbing what could be saved, the children, your child, the leaving what could not be saved, the smell of smoke, the loss of everything that was not on your body, the clothes, the food, the shelter from the rain, your shoes, the children's shoes, the baby's toys, the one surviving photo of your mother, the backpacks packed for the morning school day, the hope of a better life in a new place. But worse than this was the later knowledge, at first only rumor, that someone had done this on purpose, had lit the match, had looked upon you and those like you, different, darker, speaking a different language, as something to be eradicated. In the days after the fire, you get up each morning, try to find food and shelter, to calm the children, to gather together with those who care for you, to do what can be done in one day's time, to set aside the knowledge of the cruelty. That only a 30-minute ferry ride away are people, is it a help to know that only a 30-minute ferry ride away are people who are gathering up in large black garbage bags, linens, children's clothes, tennis shoes and flip-flops, cans of food, new backpacks, that Albury's Ferry brings it to you without charge, that perhaps, if not mercy, there is hope for mercy. This says, "My mirror says that I am becoming my grandmother." But which one? One was a member of both the DAR and the Daughters of the Confederacy. Disappointed I would not join either one. She held a high office in the Eastern Star, and though she lived to be 100, she always took her leave from us from the time she reached 50 by saying, "We may never meet again in this life," dabbing at real tears. She had been a beauty, a belle, and married well. She liked to say she couldn't cook, because she'd always had cooked. When she was widowed, That life was gone. She was doleful and disgruntled. We had to call her grandmother, not Mimi, not Nana. All pet names were disrespectful. When she recited the glorious deeds of our ancestors who commanded troops in the Civil War, called the War Between the States or the War of Northern Aggression, we listened politely and then teased her about the horse thieves in the family or whether we were related to the outlaw Jesse James, since her maiden name was James. My other grandmother lived on an Illinois farm, got up while it was still dark outside every day for 40 years to feed the men who worked the fields, bacon and eggs and homemade biscuits. All day she stumped through the house and then outside to feed the chickens and the hogs, on sturdy legs and arthritic feet, in black lace-up shoes, running down the basement stairs to pour her own cow's milk, still warm, into the separator so she could sell the cream for pin money. On her knees, taking a rag with the baseboards, she never gave work a lick and a promise, because if it's worth doing, it's worth doing well. After Sunday dinner, fried chicken, one of hers, she put on the chopping block early in the day. Beans from jars she put up at the end of summer, which stood like jewels on a basement shelf. All was followed by homemade pie. She had time for us, time to play bingo or cards. She cheated ostentatiously, daring us to catch her. And when we did, she threw back her head and laughed and said, "It's no fun if you can't cheat." When all was in order, from attic to basement, she sewed on her ancient Singer machine, making the treadle fly, her feet a blur as the needles spun through cotton she bought in town with her pin money. While she sang hymns at the top of her lungs, "When the roll is called up yonder, and this is my father's world," her daughter, when she was young enough to be embarrassed, asked her not to sing so loudly in church, and she replied, "If you're gonna sing, sing." One day, when she was younger than I am now, she lay down to grab a nap before dinner, closed her eyes, and never opened them again. I never lived on a farm, but she is my template for life. This is the gate. I have supped with ghosts, sat down with them, risen with them, walked the beach with them, slept beside them, caught a glimpse of them behind me in the mirror as I brushed my hair. Some are as familiar as the soup on my kitchen stove. Some are querulous. "What were you thinking?" one asked. I cannot answer. I don't know myself. Some are chattering, scolding ghosts. Sometimes there are several ghosts at once, part of a group that once gathered, that gathers no longer in this world. Although their conversation cheers me, floats around my head, like butterflies or bees. Some, like the ghost of my mother, come just when needed, without my calling. She stays for a few minutes, and then is gone. The gate between the living and the dead, on well-oiled hinges, swings open as well as shut. "Free press is the enemy of the state," says the Manchurian candidate. How long before our Reichstag fire? Stay angry, stay awake. This is the last poem in my book, Homecoming, because I didn't want to leave you in that bad place. This is called Advice. Swing open the skylights, hot days, dark nights, lightning over the lake, rain on the wind, then a gusher sluices down the clogged drainpipe. The door to the garden stands open. Walk through it into the scent of verbena. Let the weeds take your garden, starting next year. Plant more herbs. Drink wine while cooking. Turn up the music until the pots vibrate on the stove. Let not all dear words be lost. Turn them into song and whisper, even into the ear of death. Sit with me here in the sun on the hillside this morning. Take grief under your wing. Stroke it, soothe it, comfort it. Watch the way the leaves of the alder turn themselves silver side up in the breeze.